Penguin Audio presents Lincoln's Boys, John Hay, John Nicolay, and The War for Lincoln's Image by Joshua Zeitz, read by Malcolm Hillgartner. Prologue, June 13, 1905. Less than 3 weeks before his death, John Milton Hay awoke in his cabin room on the RMS Baltic as the great ocean liner, still the jewel of the White Star Line, steamed a course from Liverpool to New York. He reached for his diary and composed one of its final entries. It was June 1905. Electric lights and streetcars lined hundreds of American towns. Phonographs and telephones were quickly becoming common fixtures in middle-class living rooms, and for a nickel, city folk could gaze into large wood and steel boxes and marvel at moving picture images of prize fighters, ball players, and ballerinas. John D. Rockefeller and Andrew Carnegie represented the extremes of American wealth and power. It had already been 2 years since the Wright brothers conducted the first manned test flight of an airplane. In Germany, the theoretical physicist Albert Einstein had recently published a paper on the photoelectric effect and was fast at work developing his theory of relativity. In Vienna, Sigmund Freud published his path-breaking volume, Three Essays on the Theory of Sexuality. In his youth, John Hay could scarcely have imagined this world. A child of the Western Prairie, he was raised in the age of iron and grew to manhood in the age of steel. A noted poet and historian, former newspaper editor and railroad executive, Hay had served as U.S. Ambassador to Britain and, since 1898, Secretary of State, first under President William McKinley and then, after 1901, under President Theodore Roosevelt. He was one of the most powerful men in the world. But his bright spirit was fast burning out a frail body. In his final weeks, his mind wandered back to the simpler world of his youth. "I dreamed last night that I was in Washington," Hay confided to his diary, "and that I went to the White House to report to the President, who turned out to be Mr. Lincoln. He was very kind and considerate and sympathetic about my illness. He gave me two unimportant letters to answer. I was pleased that this slight order was within my power to obey. I was not in the least surprised at Lincoln's presence in the White House. But the whole impression of the dream was one of overpowering melancholy." This is the story of John Hay and John Nicolay, prairie boys who met in 1851 and forged a close friendship that endured over a half century. Fortune placed them in the right place, Springfield, Illinois, at the right time, 1860, and offered them a front-row seat to one of the most tumultuous political and military upheavals in American history, then or since. As Abraham Lincoln's private secretaries, they became, both literally and figuratively, closer to the president than anyone outside his immediate family. Still young men in their 20s, they lived and worked on the second floor of the White House, performing the roles and functions of a modern-day chief of staff, press secretary, political director, and presidential bodyman. Above all, they guarded the last door which opens into the awful presence of the commander-in-chief, in the words of Noah Brooks, a journalist and one of many Washington insiders who coveted their jobs, resented their influence, and thought them a little too big for their britches, a fault for which it seems to me either nature or our tailors are to blame, Hay once quipped. "These secretaries are young men," Brooks grumbled, "and the least said of them, the better, perhaps." In demeanor and temperament, they could not have been more different. Short-tempered and dyspeptic, Nicolay cut a brooding figure to those seeking the president's time or favor. William Stoddard, an assistant secretary under their supervision, later remarked that Nicolay was decidedly German in his manner of telling men what he thought of them. People who do not like him, because they cannot use him, perhaps, say he is sour and crusty, and it is a grand good thing, then, that he is. Hay cultivated a softer image. He was, in the words of his contemporaries, a comely young man with peach-blossom face, very witty, boyish in his manner, yet deep enough, bubbling over with some brilliant speech. an instant fixture in Washington social circles, fast friend of Robert Todd Lincoln's, and favorite among Republican congressmen who haunted the White House halls, he projected a youthful dash that balanced out Nicolay's more grim bearing. Hay and Nicolay were party to the president's greatest official acts and most private moments. They were in the room when he signed the Emancipation Proclamation, and they were by his side at Gettysburg when he first spoke to the nation of a new birth of freedom. When he could not sleep, which as the war progressed was often, Lincoln walked down the corridor to their private quarters and passed the time reciting Shakespeare or mulling over the day's political and military developments. When his son Willie passed away in 1862, the first person to whom Lincoln turned was John Nicolay. When the president drew his last breath in April 1865, John Hay was by his bedside. For the rest of their lives, even as they built their own families and careers, Hay and Nicolay inspired a certain measure of wonder and awe. The greater Lincoln grew in death, the greater they grew for having known him so well and so intimately in life. Everyone wanted to know them, if only to ask what it had been like, what he had been like. It was a tough question to answer. Abraham Lincoln worked hard at being inscrutable. The tones, the gestures, the kindling eye, and the mirth-provoking look defy the reporter's skill, wrote Brooks. William Herndon, Lincoln's law partner, could fairly claim to have known him as well as any man during the Springfield days. But to Herndon, the future president was the most shut-mouthed man who ever lived. He always told only enough of his plans and purpose to induce the belief that he had communicated all, observed another friend. Yet he reserved enough to have communicated nothing. Even Lincoln acknowledged as much. I am rather inclined to silence, he admitted, and whether that be wise or not, it is at least more unusual nowadays to find a man who can hold his tongue than to find one who cannot. If anyone knew the inner mind of the president, it was the two secretaries. Witty and prolific letter writers, observant and incisive diarists, Hay and Nicolay left a remarkable record of Lincoln's evolution as chief executive. By their later account, they came from Illinois to Washington with him and remained at his side and in his service, separately or together, until the day of his death. We were the daily and nightly witnesses of the incidents, the anxieties, the fears, and the hopes which pervaded the executive mansion and the national capital during the war. Better than anyone else, they knew where the president was, what he was doing, and what he was thinking at almost every turn. It is little wonder that historians of the era consult Hayes and Nicolay's writings freely and frequently. But their life's work after the Civil War is a largely forgotten story. The boys, as the president affectionately called them, became Lincoln's official biographers, enjoying exclusive access to his papers, which the Lincoln family closed to the public until 1947, they undertook a 25-year mission to create a definitive and enduring historical image of their slain leader. It became the great undertaking of their lives. The culmination of these efforts, their exhaustive 10-volume biography, which was widely serialized between 1886 and 1890, constituted one of the most successful exercises in historical revisionism in American history. Riding against the rising currents of Southern apologia and a popular vogue for reunion and reconciliation, Hay and Nicolay pioneered the Northern interpretation of the Civil War, an interpretation whose influence waxed and waned, but that created a standard against which every other historian and polemicist had to stake out his or her position. Hay and Nicolay helped invent the Lincoln we know today, the great emancipator, the sage father figure, the military genius, the greatest American orator, the brilliant political tactician, the master of a fractious cabinet who forged a team of rivals out of erstwhile challengers for the throne, the Lincoln Memorial Lincoln. That Abraham Lincoln was all of these things in some measure, there can be no doubt. But it is easy to forget how widely underrated Lincoln the president and Lincoln the man were on the eve of his death, and how successful Hay and Nicolay were in elevating his place in the nation's collective historical memory. While Lincoln prided himself on his deep connection to the people, that nebulous body politic in whose collective wisdom he developed an almost mystic faith, he never succeeded in translating his immense popularity with the northern public into similar regard among the nation's political and intellectual elites. The profound emotional bond that he shared with Union soldiers and their families, and his stunning electoral success in two successive presidential elections, never fully inspired.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.